Yeah.
Thanks very much. Super. Yeah, so Maureen has introduced the network, the Canadian Biotechnology Action Network. And I thought what I could do this evening is present some of the past and present of genetic engineering before Jim introduces us to GMOs 2.0. What's next from this technology? What's next from this politics of genetic engineering? And one of the ways that CBAN is able to share information with you is we did conduct an extensive investigation into the impacts and risks of genetic engineering in Canada after 20 years. We called it the GMO Inquiry. We asked 6 questions. The questions around, where are they? What are the environmental impacts? Are they better for consumers? Are they better for farmers? Are they well regulated? Do we need them to feed the world? And we wrote 6 reports based on the answers that we found. So when we were looking at genetic engineering, you know, over these 20 years, we've come to understand what's on the marketplace. I thought it was a helicopter, and yes, it is. Or something. So we're looking at this technology, and it's about human intervention at the molecular level. And you know, the genetically engineered crops that are on the shelves provide us with that first example of this intervention, which often includes or is based on the introduction of genetic material from other species, and certainly from bacterium in particular. But this isn't all of how we can define the technology. And Jim will be able to present now how we can really understand some of the variations of this intervention, this human intervention, which allows scientists to make change directly to the genetic makeup of organisms, so to change the genome of organisms. And unlike the millennia of farmer conventional breeding of plants and animals that relies on the reproductive capacities of organisms, we no longer need to look to that capacity, that we can go beyond it, which is how it is that genetic engineering provides the opportunity to move genetic material from one species to a totally different species or a different kingdom. But there's more to genetic engineering than that, and we'll talk about that process tonight. But what I wanted to do was review where we are after 20 years, where this technology has taken us so far. And it's taken us to these 4 main crops globally, which is the soybean, corn, cotton, and canola. There are 2 traits in this almost 100% of all the GM crops. These 4 crops are engineered for 2 traits, which is the herbicide tolerant trait, which you're familiar with, that allows the spraying of herbicides, and insect resistance, which is the incorporation of a toxin, the expression of a toxin by a plant so that classes of insects will die. So this is about weed control, pest control. This is what the technology has brought us to this point. And this is what it looks like when we are to look in Canada. There are 4 crops that are genetically engineered that are grown in Canada. And this is the corn, canola, soy, and white sugar beet, which is used for sugar processing. So this little list is also in a little guide that you have. And my slide is doing something funny. So this is how much. CBAN did the investigation to find out how much is actually being grown. Statistics Canada does not keep that information. It does not track which crops, which GM traits are actually on the market and how much is grown. But CBAN did this investigation, and aside from soybean, which is at 60% genetic engineering, the saturation in the market is very high. So in addition to the 4 GM crops, and if you'll hear me talk about genetic modification and genetic engineering and use these these terms interchangeably. We're talking about genetic engineering, genetic modification. These GM foods, in addition to what's grown in Canada, there are some that can be imported to Canada. Cotton, we do eat some cottonseed oil, papaya, squash, and maybe there's some bovine growth hormone still being used to produce milk products. What we do have in terms of new information, which is on this little guide that's at the back of the room, a new little presentation of what's on the market, is this question of new GM foods. Because we've heard that the GM apple has been approved, that a GM potato has been approved, a GM salmon, GM alfalfa. But these aren't on the market except for a little bit of GM alfalfa that's grown for animal feed. Not sprouts, but grown for dairy cows and other farm animals. The GM apple is not yet being grown in Canada, or the apple trees are not ready for harvest. The potato was not grown in Canada this year, and the GM salmon is not in production. So there's a little guide. This is what the cover of it looks like that has that information in it. So if we're to look here on these new, about these new genetically engineered crops, the potato, the perfect, the apple, the perfect fruit just got even better. The new genetically modified potato, a better potato. These are the promises of genetic engineering. Better, new improved crops, new improved plants. And, you know, we'll continue to see these promises. But the question is, actually, what's happened to the older promises? Because the Canadian government had said some of these new crops may reduce the need for chemical agriculture. In 2001, this is what the Canadian government said. The year before, the Canadian government spent a lot of money, in fact, $300,000, to distribute copies of this brochure, which said that biotechnology plants have been developed that tolerate herbicides. This allows farmers to spray less often and with fewer chemicals. So CBAN tested that question of this promise, and the results of our investigations were, in fact, over the lifetime of genetically modified crops in Canada, herbicide sales have increased 130%. And of course, the result of increased use of glyphosate in particular, which is the herbicide ingredient used in most, that's twinned with most of the herbicide tolerant crops grown in Canada, the genetically engineered crops, over 80% of them are these herbicide tolerant crops. The increased use of glyphosate has meant the spread, the emergence and spread of glyphosate resistant weeds, which means using glyphosate gets more complicated, and we now need to turn to other older herbicides. So certainly this promise for using less herbicides has failed abysmally as it happens. We also know that farmers are not keeping more money in their pockets. They're spending a lot of money on inputs, and that includes more expensive genetically modified seeds. There's no evidence for higher yields because of the GM traits that have been introduced. Of course, many of you are familiar with this issue that Health Canada does not conduct its own tests. It relies on industry information when it reviews questions of safety. And after 20 years, there's still no scientific consensus on generally safety questions around genetically engineered foods. And this is, you know, a controversy that you will hear in the media. There is an assertion being made that there is scientific consensus, that after 20 years we know these products are safe. That is simply not the case. And we discuss this in our reports, in the GMO inquiry reports. So after 20 years, the scientific controversy continues. We still need a lot more science. There's not enough science being done. And we see that farmers are not making more money from genetically engineered crops. And the promise, the central launching promise of genetic engineering that it would reduce herbicide use, has not happened. So now we're at a place after 20 years where there's a new set of techniques coming forward and a renewed discourse from the industry about the future of this technology. Will there be new regulations? Will there be a change in how we discuss genetic engineering with this new set of technologies, new set of techniques in genetic engineering? In 1993, Monsanto had said that the future availability of food biotechnology requires two things: regulatory approval and public acceptance. This was the case 20 years ago, and it's the case today. Companies need their products to be approved by government regulators, and they need us to eat the products. What's happening is that instead of this moment being seen as an opportunity to review and reform regulation, to prepare ourselves for new technologies, certainly, you know, 15 years ago, the Royal Society of Canada expert panel said a lot of work could be done to reform regulation to meet the future of biotechnology. That was 15 years ago. Nothing was changed in our regulatory system. Instead of seeing this moment in time as an opportunity to reform regulation, instead, industry argues this is the exact time to remove regulation, that these new technologies are more precise, they're better, they remove a lot of the risk questions, and that consumers should be newly educated about how precise the science is, and in fact, this discussion is happening right now in Canadian Parliament, that there's a new effort that needs to be made to educate consumers so that we have more confidence in the Canadian government to regulate these products and, you know, more confidence generally in genetic engineering. You'll remember this promise was part of about herbicide use was part of this pamphlet that was distributed with money from the Canadian government. And this is a discussion that's happening right now in the Agriculture Committee, which is discussing the issue of GM animals. The Agriculture Committee has heard from our organization, the Canadian Biotechnology Action Network, and we'll hear from others on Tuesday about the need to label genetically modified foods. Instead, the response appears to be, actually, shouldn't we just educate consumers? That if there's a crisis of consumer confidence in genetic engineering, that can be overcome with information, not labels. And of course, this is not new. That was what was attempted with many more hundreds of thousands of dollars in public relations 15 and 20 years ago. So if you want to take action this weekend, I encourage you to go to our website, cban.ca/gmanimals, where you have the opportunity to contact members of the Agriculture Committee and tell them if you want labeling of the GM salmon that could come to market within the next 2 to 3 years, and if you have other views on genetically modified animals. One of the things coming forward, of course, is new technologies can be used to bring forward these genetically modified animals. This is a missing slide that would present to you the corporate control that exists in seed and pesticide markets now, which is six companies controlling around 60% of the seeds and pesticide market. Many of you will have heard Monsanto and Bayer are getting ready to merge, that Bayer wants to buy Monsanto, which Monsanto, of course, is the largest seed company. And there's a great movement of mergers that would mean instead of six major companies controlling the seeds and pesticide market, it would be three. So what's going on here after 20 years of genetic engineering? There's a great deal of corporate concentration. So if we're to look at any new technologies coming forward or new techniques in genetic engineering, that we need to also ask this question of actually, how is that going to change who controls food, who controls seeds, And that's a major question before us.
So yeah, it's really wonderful to see this full room, and it's even old friends here, which I was astonished. I come from far away, as you can probably hear in my accent, but the old friends come from far away too. So I work with an organization called Etc. Group. We're a kind of a technology watchdog. We track new and emerging technologies and corporate trends, particularly around agriculture, particularly around new technologies. And so this question of GMOs, genetic engineering, is something that Etc. Group has been dealing with for 30 years, I think. I've also, as you say, I used to work with Greenpeace International on this issue. In fact, I was just saying earlier on that the first time I heard of the big carrot, I was on board, there's a Greenpeace ship, which is called the Rainbow Warrior. And I was on board the Rainbow Warrior in 1998 in New Zealand, and our cook turned out to be somebody from the big carrot, who was...
And if you say their name...
She's know. Called Julie. Some of you, she's
yeah,
some of you know Julie. And she told me in New Zealand that so she was working with this local grocery store, and they were going through their entire catalog, making sure they knew what was GMO. And I thought it was amazing. I remembered that name, the big carrot. And here I am. I'm really pleased. So if any of you see Julie, you know her, say hello from me. 20 years ago, going back to GMOs 1.0, so 20 years ago, almost to the month, I found myself on one of those little rubber Greenpeace ships in front of this massive hulking ship, Violetta Lewowski. This was the first shipment of genetically engineered soybeans to come into the UK. And it was being brought into Liverpool Harbour, Merseyside in the UK. And as I say, I was on a little rubber boat, and we were going to try and stop this, the first ever genetically modified crops coming into the UK. And the plan was that we were going to get in front of it. It had to go through a kind of like narrow channel. And then we were going to, I was going to get out the ship and tie myself to the ladder so that it couldn't go through without crushing me and a couple of other people, and that was how we were going to stop genetically modified organisms getting into the food supply in the UK. And at about the point where we this came on the horizon, and I remember my jaw dropping at how huge this thing was. It's like an air tanker, an aircraft carrier. At exactly that point, our boat's engine cut out. And I had to get pulled to shore, and ended up spending the rest of that day kind of trying to get a rubber boat out of the Mersey. And the next day, a group of us decided that we would take this issue instead to the supermarkets. And we went to a local supermarket, and we started putting stickers on some of the products that would have genetically modified soy once it got into the food supply, which the day before it just had, basically. Giving out information to consumers and saying, look, this is what's coming. This huge tanker is coming right here to your grocery aisle. And what became clear was that was the way that we were going to stop genetically modified organisms in the UK. It was in the grocery aisles, not in the Mersey. Because people had a very strong sense of this was not something they were comfortable with in their food supply. And so for much of the years following that, I was involved, and others as well, producing various guides to how consumers can know where these are turning up in their products, in their grocery aisles. These are various guides from around the world, shopping guides. And I think that's really what's changed the story on GMOs 1.0, which is what you were just hearing about, whether in Europe and also here in North America. And so I'm really glad that tonight we're going to be sharing this, if anyone hasn't got it, which is the first ever shopping guide or consumer's guide on GMOs 2.0, which is, if you like, the next big super tanker of genetic engineering heading our way. And I think it really is important to have consumers, ordinary people, talking about what this means for their food supply and beginning to understand. So thanks for this opportunity to talk about this. I'm using this term, GMOs 2.0. Next generation genetic engineering, extreme genetic engineering, new GM. What's clear from anyone who's sort of working around this issue, and you heard it from what Lucy was saying, is that there's a shift going on in this area of genetic engineering, that what's been happening for 20 years is becoming something new. And I want to talk about what the difference is and also what the continuities are, how the genetic engineering of our food supply is shifting And basically, it's the underlying technology that's shifting, but it has some implications. Just to sort of dial back a little bit to sort of understand, Lucy said it very well, that what genetic engineering is sort of human interference, if you like, with the genetic code of life in a sort of deliberate way. That if you were to, it's not as straightforward as this, but if you were to say that within all living things there is this DNA code, which is kind of a code of instructions of how an organism grows and how it expresses different traits, that code, if you could rewrite it in some way, then you can change the way the organism behaves and grows and so forth. You know, it might be useful to think about, and that code is literally a physical code. It's four chemical letters, G, T, C, and A. I sometimes find it helpful to think about it almost like a ticker tape. You know, some people here will remember when the way in which you programmed a computer was you fed in a ticker tape, and that was a physical thing that programmed the computer. Just as you know, a ticker tape would run these kind of computers, so a living organism, in a way, DNA is kind of the instruction code going into it. It's not exactly that. In fact, part of the problem of genetic engineering is it oversimplifies this idea that you're just programming a code. But for thinking about GMOs 2.0, it's a helpful metaphor. And so in the old style genetic engineering, what Lucy just presented, what was effectively happening was that genetic engineers were finding bits of that code, cutting it out, and pasting it across from one organism to the other, or even sometimes within the same species. But it was a sort of experimental approach, a cut and paste. That, you know, what you would have to do is look through the DNA that's out there, whether it's the DNA in a bacteria or in a scorpion or whatever it is, find a stretch of that DNA that seemed to be responsible for a color or producing a pesticide or whatever, cut it out, and then try and get it into the DNA sequence of the organism you wanted to change. And with that first generation, so-called transgenic, where you're moving between species, there were basically two ways you could do that. Once you had your little piece of DNA and you'd cut it out, you could either fire it into the DNA on a little golden bullet, what's called the ballistic method. Doesn't look quite like that, but it's the same principle, until it kind of lodges there in the DNA and becomes part of the code. Or you could get a little virus or bacteria that would then infect it. And so you basically have these two ways of changing the code of life. The difference now, 20 years later, is genetic engineers have many ways of doing this. Over 20 years, they've developed new techniques, new approaches, where you can rewrite that kind of central ticker tape, if you like. And you know, here's a list of some of them. It doesn't really matter what the names are or how they work, but there are different ways in which you can get genetic material into an organism. And what this means is that you've got a whole new way of building life forms. That previously you had a rather simplistic experimental way of building life forms, what we call transgenics, and now you have a whole new way of building life forms, which is sometimes called synthetic biology. Have people heard that term, synthetic biology? Some have. It's the term that this industry has very much been gravitating around. Synthetic biology. And in some ways, I just want to show you this graph, because I think this is kind of interesting. This was a graph that was done, if you can see this, by the US Department of Commerce back in about 2007. And what they were saying was the old way of producing genetic engineered organisms, it was creating more and more organisms at a sort of steady rate. But the new way of doing it, with these new techniques, kind of digital genetic engineering, which I'll talk about in a second, was beginning in about 2008, 2009, was beginning to really take off. And you would see this point happen where the new way of doing genetic engineering would become the way in which you change organisms. Does that make sense? Yeah. Somewhere about...
So did it start in 2009?
Before that, really, but that's when this platform called synthetic biology began to come together. And certainly I would say that by this point, by 2016, we're about here for sure. That basically most genetic engineering that's going on is using these new sets of techniques. This is how you do it. And I think of this often as being rather similar to what happened around digital production of images. Mm-hmm. That if you go back to about some point in the 1990s, before that, you probably would have used a normal camera or a film camera, And there was some point at which using a digital camera became the way in which you got digital images. And now it's the way in which we get all our images. And you know, because of digital approaches, we can move an image from here to there. We could do all sorts of things. And the number of images in the world has gone up exponentially. Apparently, there were 1 trillion photos in 2015, apparently. So this new platform, this very flexible digital platform, has changed the way in which image production has happened. And the same is happening with digital life, basically. So synthetic biology, this new platform has a few characteristics. One is that you're no longer going out and looking for those bits of DNA in nature. Remember that picture of the guy looking through the ticker tape? Now you can build the DNA. It's been true since about the 1960s that because DNA is it's a chemical, it's a molecule, you can build DNA, but now you have machines, they're called DNA synthesizers. You can tell the machine that I want a piece of DNA that goes in the code GTTCCAGGTC, whatever, and it will print it out on one of these machines here, and then there you have it. Or you can go to the internet, you can go to a company like DNA 2.0, you can order a piece of DNA to any code you want, and they'll produce it and they'll send it to you by FedEx, and you'll get it in about a week's time. And every one of those letters costs you 30 cents. So if you want a piece of DNA that goes GTTCCAGGTCC, then that's 30 cents, 30 cents, 30 cents, and they'll print it out and they'll send it to you, and it's ready to genetically engineer into an organism. This is the new world of synthetic DNA. It's broadly available. The second thing is, once you've got that, you can begin to imagine that DNA is almost like having kind of little components. It's almost like an engineering language. So you know, those bits of code are like parts of a programming language. And so you can make it more like engineering, less experimental. You can say, I want the DNA command that says turn on, and the DNA command that says glow green, and the DNA command that says flash, and the DNA command that says turn off. And that makes a program, and you can put that into an organism, and the organism will supposedly turn on, flash green, and turn off again. And so you now get these bits of DNA, which are called biobricks, which come together into a programming language. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So, and the third is, in fact, you don't need to actually get new DNA, because we now have tools that are called genome editing, where you can take a piece of DNA, you can go through, and you can just change one letter, or two letters, or five letters at a time, and you can rewrite it, like you're rewriting a sentence on a word processor. And these genome editing tools, with names like CRISPR and Talens and Zinc Fingers, have become all the rage, that it's possible to go in, change the DNA in situ, and not have to add anything. You change it where it is, but you change it into something else. And what this means is we're moving from a world where it used to be you had to find the DNA to a world where you now just design the DNA as you want. We've moved from a kind of a cut and paste approach to genetic engineering to what's more like a desktop publishing, in a way. So you can desktop publish organisms. That's effectively what's going on here. And the idea behind this is, therefore, you can kind of program living organisms as you want, as if this was a programming language. And so life, synthetic life, becomes this many-varied thing. It becomes this digital, remixable, programmable thing. And you can begin to imagine, especially if you're a young person who's used to programming all sorts of things, life becoming a programmable a substrate is a very exciting opportunity. What does that mean? If you can program life supposedly to order, if you can build to order, well, it means that you can make very quickly quite interesting things. This is a competition that happens every year. It's happening about 2 weeks in Boston, called the International Genetically Engineered Machine Competition. This year, I think it's 300 groups of mostly high school students, but also some from universities, but mostly that kind of level, undergraduate, high school. And these teams will compete to make the coolest genetically engineered organism. They will program organisms to flash different colors, to smell like bananas, to do all sorts of interesting things, and see who can win this kind of Olympiad or jamboree. Many of those are beginning to move on now to setting up companies. or are being recruited by companies. And so you have this growing synthetic biology industry that's using these techniques of reprogramming life forms and is partnering with the largest chemical companies, energy companies, food and fragrance companies, flavor companies, and so forth. And a lot of money's running in. This year alone, there's been about $900 million of venture capital money. There are billions of dollars of investment, and a lot of government funding as well. So we're seeing now this new revitalized biotechnology industry, sometimes calls itself the synthetic biology industry, which is bringing forth quite unusual things. You heard from Lucy about what the biotech industry has been up till now, at least in foods and crops. And suddenly there's this sort of new player on the block. There's all sorts of unusual genetically engineered organisms being brought into production. And we're seeing three waves of this new GMO 2.0, next generation genetic engineering, synthetic biology, whatever you want to call it. The first is biosynthesis. And I'll talk about this quite a lot. But basically this is engineering organisms to produce compounds, foods, flavors, fragrances, oils, in large vats. The second is engineering organisms to put out into the environment, whether that's crops or animals or mosquitoes or fish, sort of more like we were hearing with the first generation of GMOs. And the third is a wave that's about using DNA as a computing mechanism. So DNA is a kind of code, and we'll use this as a way of doing sort of molecular computing. I won't talk so much about that, but that's kind of coming too. Biosynthesis. This is where I mostly want to talk about tonight, because this is what's coming into the marketplace now, and it's what we're mostly covering in this guide. Is this making sense, by the way? I hope I'm not going too fast. If I am, tell me to slow down. What we're talking about here is making stuff in vats. Does anyone here do fermentation at home? Yay. Kombucha or, yeah. So pickles. So, you know, the idea of taking an organism, whether it's yeast or bacteria, in order to ferment sugar into making something new, whether it's beer or wine or kombucha, is not new. But what is new is if you can change that organism, if you can rewrite or reprogram that organism so that rather than produce kombucha, it produces vanilla, or rather than produce kombucha, it produces biofuels or plastics or something like that. And that's what this biosynthesis industry is doing. They're imagining that those bacteria or the yeast for fermentation are like a little factory, a little chemical factory. And they're reprogramming that chemical factory, taking the sequences that make vanilla or that make something glow green, putting those into the organism using the tools of synthetic biology, so that they now have a little factory that does whatever the output is they want, the compound they want. You then multiply up those new genetically engineered organisms, yeast, algae, bacteria, in a big fermentation vat, and it produces the compound you want. Let's say it's vanilla flavor, and you can then sell that on the open market for use in ice creams or soft drinks or things like that. That's how this area is working. Does that make sense? So the first wave of synthetic biology initially started by saying, let's do that. Let's do this fermentation and we'll make biofuels. Because biofuels were seen as the big market at about the end of the last decade. The chance of making large fermentation of biofuels, not ethanol, but things that looked a bit like more like jet fuel or that looked more like gasoline. And also plastics and other industrial chemicals. And so we do have some bioplastics that are made through synthetic biology. We have some work on biofuels. Mostly this area didn't work because the quantities that were required to make for it to be profitable were not possible to make in vats. There was all sorts of contamination. So the industry looked around and said, okay, if we can't make large quantities of something, is there something we can make in smaller quantities that's very valuable? And very quickly they realized there was. They were called secondary metabolites, natural plant products. In fact, the most valuable things that they could make are the flavors and fragrances and oils that come off of plants that are currently natural plant products. So you have companies like this. This is a company called Evolver. And Evolver, basically, this is what they're working on. they've sort of done a scan of the market and said, well, the most valuable spice in the world is saffron. So they're making saffron, there is in the corner. The second most valuable spice in the world is vanilla, so we're making vanilla. The third most valuable spice, and so on. And so every one of those, they're now making synthetically in a vat using synthetic biology, in yeast in this case.
Breast milk?
Breast milk, yeah. Some of the key compounds of human breast milk they're making as well. And particularly for the food and flavors industry, this is very exciting. There's some of the things, vanilla, stevia. I'll talk about more of these about these in a minute. But cosmetics, fragrances, soaps, we're seeing all of these. Some of you may have known Ecova. I think is Ecova sold here? Mm-hmm. Ecova, we're going to use a synthetic biology thing. I'll talk about that in a minute. Squalane, which is used in moisturizers. Something like a third of the squalane on the market now is synthetic biology. The companies that are really embracing this in a big way right now are companies like Firmenich, International Flavors and Fragrances, Givaudan. These are big fragrance and flavor houses that produce hundreds, sometimes thousands, of different flavors and fragrances that they then sell on to cosmetics companies, to food companies. They're sort of big, complex ingredient houses. And these companies, you know, they're very much controlled by a small number. So they put here, you know, there's 10 companies that control 80% of this flavors and fragrance market. And six of these 10 companies are working with synthetic biology. And what excites them about it is, at the moment, they source from hundreds of thousands, if not millions, of farmers from around the world. That's very complicated. They would rather source from a few large vats. And so you can synthesize the entire world's supply of patchouli in one vat in Brazil over a one-month period. And then you don't have to be sourcing patchouli from many different patchouli growers in India and Indonesia and Philippines. For the flavor and fragrance companies, that's exciting. The second thing, and they have to worry about weather and hurricanes and anything like that, it's just there. The second is, it turns out that if you ferment something in a vat, you can call it natural, because fermentation, whether it's kombucha or whatever, is considered natural under US law and European law and I think Canadian law. So even though it's a synthetically engineered organism that's doing the fermenting, what comes out of it can be called natural, and you can say natural flavors, natural fragrances. And you can do it cheaper than getting it from a farmer. That's extremely exciting to these companies. They can now start to sell natural ingredients, natural, that are made from extreme genetic engineering. And it turns out that the markup on using the word natural is higher than the markup on using the word organic. There's no regulation on the word natural. The third, of course, is price. You're no longer dealing with fluctuations in price because of seasons and things like that. All you need to do is have a steady supply of sugar to put in your fermentation vat. And increasingly, it's not even sugar. You can use natural gas. What does that mean? Well, that means that it's good for the natural, the flavors and fragrance industry. It's not so good from who they previously sourced all those from, which is to say farmers, pickers, harvesters. The flavors and fragrance industry, it supports probably about 20 million small-scale farmers. I think they put it here, 200 to 250 different botanical crops that go into that industry. And all of that is now, particularly from the tropics, all of that is now threatened by this new natural synthetic industry. Drugs, pharmaceuticals, probiotics, we're seeing also production of those. And I want to give a few examples. So the poster child actually is a drug. And it's taught to a lot by synthetic biologists. It's a drug called artemisinin. Artemisinin is produced by the Artemisia annua plant. It's a Chinese sweet wormwood plant. And it's at this point, it's the preferred compound for anti-malarial compound in the world, supported by the World Health Organization and so forth. It's grown by about 100,000 farmers worldwide, or it was grown by about 100,000 farmers worldwide. And I'll get to that in a second. Mostly in China, Vietnam, Madagascar is very important, Tanzania, Mozambique, places in the east of Africa. This guy, synthetic biologist called Jay Kiesling, realized that he could make artemisinin in a yeast, and he got a $56 million grant from the Gates Foundation to make a yeast, a synthetic biology yeast, that would make a precursor to artemisinin. And they then worked with Sanofi Aventis to produce this. And initially, they said that this was not going to threaten the growers of Artemisia. It would just be there for the times when the supply was low because of weather and other things. In 2013, they produced one batch of artemisinin synthetically that was equivalent to a third of the world's supply. And on the day they announced that, they also said, he said, in fact, he said it to me. I was at the meeting and I asked him the question. He said, ultimately, we're going to move over the entire supply. He said effectively to those 100,000 farmers, thank you, but you're out of business now. The effect, as you might imagine, was not great. Directly after that announcement, the price of artemisinin crashed. And the following year, the planting area of Artemisia dropped by two-thirds. That in fact, this announcement created tremendous volatility with a lot of farmers saying, fine, that's it, we're out of here. Which is a dangerous thing when you're talking about an anti-malarial crop, to be introducing that kind of volatility. And one of the concerns is we're going to see exactly this happen after another natural product, whether it's patchouli or vanilla or stevia, that as farmers find that they have these new synthetic competitors, they're going to not be able to sell into these markets, and we're going to see the loss of the natural production. Vanilla is one I brought up quite a few times. Because there is a synthetic biology vanilla flavor that's on the market already. It's produced by Evolver and IFF. And it's exactly one of these examples where the company is saying that this is natural. Of course, there is artificial vanilla. There's been artificial vanilla for maybe 100 years, which is produced synthetically through synthetic chemistry. But if you use synthetic vanilla in your ice cream or your granola, you have to say artificial vanilla. If you use a synthetic biology vanilla, you can say with natural flavors. But they sell it at a lower price. And so immediately there's a competition. Now that has a real implication for vanilla farmers who have been over the years very much affected by the artificial vanillin. But particularly in places like Madagascar, still produce significant quantities of natural vanilla. There are 200,000 farmers, roughly, we think, who produce natural vanilla.
Real natural,
exactly, from beans. Bean-derived, we'd now call it. And these, unfortunately, are some of the poorest, most vulnerable people in the world. My colleagues in Africa have been and visited and met with them. In places like Sambava region in Madagascar, it's very remote. It's a very difficult crop to grow. You have to hand pollinate it, which is tricky. It has to grow under shade. It has to grow in the forest. It has to grow up the trees in the forest. It's a very complicated thing to grow. But one of the implications of that is that it's also very much caught in with the forest, that growing vanilla is a forest protection option because you need the forest for the vanilla to grow. If you haven't got the market for the vanilla, there's not an economic incentive to retain the forest. So there's a biodiversity benefit of continuing to grow vanilla in the forest and giving people a livelihood than just building it in vats. All of that's threatened. Drying the vanillas. They have to, in Madagascar, they when they pick the pods, they put them out every day to dry in the sun, and every night they have to close them up and put them away, and every morning they open them up, and they do that for months at a time. It's a very laborious process. By contrast, if you're making a synthetic biology vanilla, you're talking about a couple of days fermentation in a large vat, and that's it. So you can see the difference here.
Can I just ask one question?
Yeah.
In all these products, is there any of the original vanilla, any of the original saffron or whatever?
No, not at all. Patchouli is another crop that's being replaced with synthetic biology. There's a patchouli ingredient. It's called Clearwood. It's already used by Tom Ford and others. It's in quite a few products. Vetiver, which is grown in Haiti. It's actually probably the most important agricultural export for Haiti. A synthetic biology version has been produced by Evolver. That could have been devastating for Haiti. Evolver have actually told us they're not going to go ahead with commercializing it, which we're glad to hear. because that would have had a huge impact. There's a number of citrus oils that are produced through synthetic biology, sold as natural, that are on the market. Grapefruit flavor and other things. Ginger, something called beta-alanine comes from ginger, now being produced through synthetic biology. Well, so I don't know if that's, in this case, in terms of synthetic biology, no. And they would claim these are single compounds and that they're identical to the natural compounds. But there are, you know, I think there are questions to be asked. When you produce something through genetic engineering, often you can get secondary compounds being produced unexpectedly. And so the question would be if you have contamination, and there has been with the Artemisia proof of actually there having been some other compounds being boosted unexpectedly. I can come to that in the questions. I was just this last week in Grenada. Grenada in the Caribbean is a major producer of cocoa butter. And this company, Solazyme, is producing a synthetic biology equivalent to cocoa butter made out of algae, synthetically engineered algae. And it also replaces shea butter. I think it's interesting what they're saying here. They're saying this is their boast, the synthetic biology company. We can dislocate the production of that oil from a tropical climate to the middle of Iowa in winter. It's truly revolutionary that we can take what is a normal crop cycle and compress that into 3 days. Now, when I read that in Grenada, the cocoa farmers were horrified, as you could imagine, because what they spend a year growing and tending and bringing to market very proudly is being replaced by a vat of genetically engineered corn and synthetic microbes in Iowa. And it goes on and on. I'm not going to go through all of these. Hello. Because it's not going to let me. here we go. I mentioned briefly squalane. It's in quite a lot of products. What's interesting, so this is squalane is a moisturizer. And it used to be produced from sharks. And so one of the things this company says is they now produce it without having to kill any sharks. In fact, most of squalane in the world is now produced from olives, so they're being misleading on this. But it's interesting, this is how they sell it. Sustainably sourced, plant-derived, GMO-free. It's produced from a synthetically engineered organism, and they say it's GMO-free.
Why?
Because it's not made from genetically engineered corn or genetically engineered soy. EcoCert approved. So EcoCert is a certifier who's happy to approve this in their cosmetic standard, and there's a couple actually. The Natural Seal, if anyone's seen the Natural Seal, is also happy to approve synthetic engineered organisms. So these are being very much sold as natural, eco, sustainable, and we're seeing this a lot in this field. Probably the largest synthetic biology ingredient we're going to see in the food chain as of this year is going to be stevia. Stevia, of course, is a sweetener, is becoming very popular. And it's being grown now. It was originally from Paraguay. It's being grown in China and Kenya and the US and so on. One of the problems, so stevia has different, what are called stevia sides. You might have seen if you got something that's got stevia in it, stevia sweetened, it's Riboside A, Riboside M, Riboside D. The problem with the most popular one, Riboside A and Riboside C, is that it has a kind of bitter aftertaste, a kind of metallic aftertaste. And so they've gone looking for other stevia sides that don't have that metallic aftertaste. And Cargill, DSM, Evolva, all of these companies have now got synthetic biology versions of stevia that don't have that bitter aftertaste.
You can buy a stevia organic one.
Yeah, so organic stevia is not this. This is a single ingredient that's going to go into things like Coke Life or Pepsi True or whatever it's called. And this is going to come into the market next year, at the end of this year. It's already been announced. It's called Eversweet. And it should go in a big way into the North American market towards the end of this year, beginning of next year. They're already increasing the quantities at the moment. What's exciting to them is they can call it natural. So Coke, for example, is all natural ingredients. This can be natural. It is stevia, which is seen as natural by consumers. And at the same time, it doesn't have that bitter aftertaste. And so that's why this Cargill thinks this is going to be a huge seller. Resveratrol is something that might be being sold downstairs. A lot of that's now synthetic biology. Saffron, I mentioned, is on the way. I can keep going through these. Agar wood, ginseng, Oh, cannabis. I noticed there are a number of cannabis places along here. There's now about three or four companies that are producing, that are working on about ready to market synthetic biology cannabidiol, which is a cannabinoid found in cannabis plants, and it's very popular. And it can now be made through synthetic biology. One of the ways in which this is being very much promoted is that it will be possible to buy CBD, cannabidiol, from this without growing any cannabis plants. So you haven't got the problem of growing cannabis plants, which are illegal, but you can still provide this particular ingredient. So this is a large market looming on synthetic biology cannabinoids. As well as there's increasingly a lot of money going into the idea of making animal replacement products. So this is a company called Mufri. They've actually just changed their name to Perfect Day. And next year, they're hoping to bring out a synthetic biology milk. So it's cow's milk protein, but it's not from a cow. It's from a synthetically engineered yeast. The reason why it's been called Perfect Day is apparently if you sing Perfect Day, the Lou Reed song, to cows, cows like it. And so the idea is that cows like, it's really confusing. Anyway, it's not just cow's milk. There's also a company who's doing the same with gelatin. There's another who's doing it with eggs, Clara Food. And there's a lot of interest. I've been going to the natural products, large natural products markets, Expo West, Expo East. And there's a lot of excitement amongst vegan producers about this idea of synthetically engineered ingredients where they can have eggs and milk and gelatin without having animal rights impacts. And there's even a new name for this. It's being called clean food. So if you begin hearing about clean food, that's what you're talking. This is what it's about, synthetic biology. I'm going to go through that. The next wave of GMOs, of synthetic biology, of GMOs 2.0, as I mentioned, is crops and insects and animals. And so here we're moving away from the stuff in a vat to, once again, as with GMOs 1.0, engineering the organism. And in this area, what's becoming clear is that this area, what I mentioned earlier, was called genome editing, is becoming very important. So this is where you would go in and you would change the DNA sequences one or two letters at a time. Does this make sense? And the biotechnology industry has been saying their ability to do this with new techniques with names like CRISPR and talons and zinc fingers, because they're not bringing in new material, because they're not taking something from here and moving it over here, it's not a GMO. They're making this claim, this is not genetically modified organism because there's no new material. They've just changed the material that's already in the plant or the animal. And they've been pushing through various governments and in the EU for this what they call new plant breeding techniques to be seen as not genetic engineering, so that they don't have to be labeled, they don't have to be regulated. And they've made rather complicated legal arguments about why that's the case, and that seems to be getting some traction. They argue that if you can change just one or another letter, it's much more precise. And so therefore, you don't have the safety issues. You get exactly the outcome you want. You don't use foreign DNA. They're saying consumers are concerned about foreign DNA. There's no foreign DNA. Consumers aren't concerned about it. Let's not tar it with the GMO name. They've seen the power of the anti-GMO movement, the non-GMO project with 40,000 products. And they want to say, this isn't GMOs. It's something else. And in response, those in civil society, NGOs, and the organic movement said, well, wait, this is genetic engineering. In fact, this is doubling down on genetic engineering. This is more intensive genetic engineering, that you're still changing the organism, and that when you get in there and you change the DNA, you have all sorts of secondary effects. And it might be that you try and change it at one location, but you have effects elsewhere on the DNA that you don't expect. And all of those problems, the kind of fundamental problems with changing genomes, all of that still exists and is in fact probably more problematic.
Like time travel where you go back and just do one little tweak there and then you get back into the future. Is that quite right?
Yeah.
Where you're saying, okay, they can say it's not GMO because it's not new material. They're just changing things around. Well, what about when you said that that say saffron doesn't have any saffron in it.
Yeah.
So how is that different?
So when they're making things in vats, what they're saying there is that the genetically engineered organism is the yeast. But the thing that comes out of it, that's not an organism, it's just a compound. So it's not genetically engineered. They'll use that language. That's why they were saying, for example, the moisturizer was non-GMO, because it's just a compound, it's not an organism. In this case, they're saying, yes, it's an organism, but the way in which it's been modified isn't GMOs like you used to have, so therefore it's not a GMO. What's interesting is the way in which the biotech industry is trying to get around opposition, regulations, labeling the GMOs, and say this is something new. In the last year or so, we've seen the largest GMO companies, Monsanto, Syngenta, DuPont, going all in for this new genome editing, CRISPR, particularly this one technique that they're very excited about. And DuPont saying they're going to have CRISPR crops by in five years' time on people's plates. And we already have one ingredient in the marketplace, at least in the US, and it's coming to Canada this year, which is a canola that's been gene edited, where a few, I think it's even two or three base pairs, letters of the DNA, have been changed. And that's now already out in fields. It's grown over 80,000 hectares in the US. It's now just been approved in Canada. And that's a gene-edited canola oil. And this company, Cibus, are selling this as a non-GMO canola oil. In fact, they give farmers a premium. Cargill give them a premium for selling their canola oil to them so they can sell it as non-GMO. And so, very directly, they are selling this as non-GMO. That's the...
Can we hold our questions till the end?
I can explain a bit more, yeah. So that's one that's already on the market, being sold as non-transgenic or non-GMO, and we're going to see more of that, especially in Canada. Lucy mentioned the apples and the potatoes that are now coming onto the market from Okanagan Fruits or in Trexon. These use something called RNAi, slightly different. It's about interfering through producing short strands of RNA. But it's kind of in the same general bucket. And coming down the road very soon, which the genetic engineering companies are very interested in, is something called RNAi sprays. So just very briefly, here what you're doing is you're producing tiny strands of not DNA, which is the main coding molecule, but RNA, which is a kind of messenger molecule. You're producing tiny strands of this RNA synthetically in large quantities, and then you're spraying it over a crop. And it's an active genetic molecule. It'll interfere with the genetics of an insect or the genetics of a crop such that it will stop the insect from being able to reproduce or something like that. In this case, what's exciting to Monsanto particularly about this, because they're very into this, is that they're not engineering an organism. There's no engineered organism. It's just a spray of RNA. Of course, what it does is it engineers the organism that it gets into. But in itself, it's just a chemical spray. And so once again, they can say this is not a GMO. This falls outside of GMO regulations. And so RNA sprays, which are not yet on the market, but they're pushing as fast as they can to get them, are going to be a very big issue. Just to take you further down the rabbit hole here, somebody said not to scare you, and this is the scary part, I'm afraid. The ability to do this kind of precise modification through genome editing has brought up a new technology that's only come into existence in the last year and a half, and this is called gene drives. So if I was to engineer an organism, let's say a fly, and I was to release that into the environment, we can expect that about half of its offspring would get the engineered trait. So I made that fly glow green. Half of its offspring would also glow green, and half of their offspring, and half of their offspring. And eventually, you would still have some flies out there in the environment which glow green, but they'd be kind of overwhelmed by the general population. This is what we've been told continually by genetic engineering companies. Don't worry if this stuff gets out, because it will get overwhelmed and get lost in the wild. Well, this new technology, gene drives, switches that around. It makes sure that every time an organism reproduces, all of its offspring carry the trait. So not 50%, but 100%. And that means as you go down, 100% of its offspring glow green, and then 100% of its offspring glow green. And as you go down the generations, you find yourself suddenly realizing that the entire population is glowing green. And eventually, because things move around, the entire species. This is a new technique which allows you to modify not just a single organism, but once you release it into the environment, to modify entire populations or entire species, and by driving a trait through the entire population. And it's, to me, it's astonishing, as someone who's worked on genetic engineering for 20 years, and we were originally told, don't worry, this technology will be kept in a lab. It won't be allowed out. And then we were told, we're going to get it in field trials, but it won't go into broadly into the population. And then we were told, we're going to use it in agriculture, but it's not going to affect the wild because the genes are going to get lost in the wild. And now we're being told, not only is it going to be released into the wild, it's going to take over the wild and take over entire species. This is what a gene drive is. The application of gene drives that gets most talked about, because the Gates Foundation has just put $75 million into it, is the idea of engineering mosquitoes, so that a mosquito that might carry malaria or Zika will not be able to reproduce, or will only produce male offspring, which means that ultimately the whole population will crash. And so this is seen as a public health good. If you can release these gene drive mosquitoes, you can crash the mosquito population, and as a result of which you won't have carrying of malaria or Zika. Well, that's an interesting possibility. There are some concerns around that, particularly ecological effects and so forth. But this does seem to work. There's been a few proof of principle. The first one is, it's called the mutagenic chain reaction. The first gene drive experiment that worked was the beginning of 2015. They changed flies so the flies would be yellow. They put a few in a box with a whole load of other flies, and then a few weeks later they opened up the box and every single fly that came out was yellow, and they were stunned. As the guy who did it here says, we were stunned. It was like the sun rose in the west rather than the east. This shouldn't happen. And now we have this ability to change entire species. And you would think that would get people concerned, but in fact it's getting people excited. So here's a project, five partners including an NGO, who would like to release gene drive mice on islands. The reason they want to do that is because mice are an invasive species that are killing birds and so forth. If you can release gene drive mice onto islands, then you would remove that invasive species. And they hope to have this, the G-bird, the daughterless mouse project, because their mice will all have male offspring by 2020, which is pretty soon. Similar things are being proposed in Hawaii to release mosquitoes. There are mosquitoes there that are hurting this bird, a honey creeper. It's a very important, iconic bird for Hawaii, and it's suffering from something called avian malaria. If you could eradicate the mosquito that carries avian malaria, the argument goes, maybe you could save the honey creeper. And there's a number of proposals for that, too. Many of us think this is dangerous and mad. Just earlier this summer, a number of leading conservationists, including David Suzuki, who you mentioned, Jane Goodall, Nell Newman, Paul Watson, Vandana Shiva, in fact, 30 leading conservationist environmentalists put out this statement saying there's no place for gene drives in conservation, and they're calling for a halt to all proposals for the use of gene drives. But ultimately, this isn't about conservation. This technology can go to a number of places. It's a very powerful bioweapon. A lot of the money is going from the US defense establishment. But ultimately, what we find talking to the gene drive developers is that they hope to use it in agriculture. So Lucy was talking earlier about glyphosate resistance, that we're now seeing many fields, especially across North America, that have weeds that are resistant to glyphosate, to Roundup. This is pigweed. This is one of the worst offenders. And the companies are saying if they can put a gene drive into pigweed, then they can eradicate this glyphosate resistance. They can, in fact, make pigweed more susceptible to Roundup. And so you can begin to not just modify the crops that you grow in the field, but also the weeds in the field. And you begin to see how this is a very different form of genetic engineering of agriculture. So what does that mean to somebody who's in the big carrot and says, well, I knew about GMOs, and now there's all of this stuff. RNAi, synthetic biology, does natural mean natural? It's going to be tricky. And that's certainly why we produce this as a start. So this is a report that Et Cetera Group, Friends of the Earth, and working with others, produces just as a sort of introduction to begin to help consumers get their head around. You might know about GMOs. There's more coming. Let's begin to think about this before they really hit your food supply in a big way. The good news, as you'll see from this, we're starting to label what you should look out for. You know, if you do see algal butter or algal oil on something, be concerned. That's a synthetic biology ingredient. If you do see Eversweet, that's a synthetic biology ingredient. If you do see Clearwood, so there's some things we can begin to already say are there. And there are also beginning to be companies who are saying, and writing statements saying, we're not going to use synthetic biology. Ben and Jerry's have a very strong policy of not using synthetic biology ingredients. Some of these other, Dr. Bronner's and Ativa. The non-GMO project, which of course Big Carrot's played a huge part in, has said that they will not allow their non-GMO project butterfly logo to go on anything that's from synthetic biology or GMOs 2.0. That's 40,000 products right there. And in fact, a couple of other brands, Made Safe brand, NSF certified brand, and this new Cosmos Organic, this is a new cosmetic standard, organic cosmetic standard, that's going to be launched in January in the EU, is also going to exclude these. Organic, there's still a process going through to try and make sure that organic excludes synthetic biology, should, genetic engineering. It has to be kind of tapped down and written for sure, but hopefully ultimately it will be. Here's some places you can find some more information, but maybe we can just talk. Thank you.